الله أكبر.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته ومنتهى علمه وجميع ما شاء وخلق وترعى وبرع، عالم الغيب وشهادة الرحمن الرحيم، الملك القدوس العزيز الحكيم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت، بيده الخير، وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على دينه ولو كره المشركون. أما بعد، فيقول الله تعالى في كتابه في سورة النور: وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. وَعَنْ أَبِي سَعِيدِ الْخُدْرِيِّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ أَنَّ نَبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ: كَانَ فِيمَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ رَجُلٌ قَتَلَ 99 نَفْسًا فسأل أن أعلم أهل الأرض فدل على راهب فأتاه فقال: إنه قتل 99 نفسا فهل له من توبة؟ فقال: لا. فقتله فكمل به 100. ثم سأل أن أعلم أهل الأرض فدل على رجل عالم فقال: إنه قتل 100 نفس فهل له من توبة؟ فقال: نعم، ومن يحول بينه وبين توبة. انطلق إلى الأرض كذا وكذا، فإن بها أناسا يعبدون الله تعالى، فاعبد الله معهم، ولا ترجع إلى أرضك فإنها أرض سوء. فانطلق حتى إذا نصف الطريق أتاه الموت فاقتسمت فيه ملائكة الرحمة وملائكة العذاب. فقالت ملائكة الرحمة: جاء نائبا مقبلا بقلبه إلى الله تعالى. فقالت ملائكة العذاب: إنه لم يعمل خيرا قط. فأتاه ملك في صورة آدمي فجعله بينهم، أي حكما. فقال: كيسوا ما بين الأرضين، فإلى أيتهما كان أدنى فهو له. فقاسوا فوجده الأدنى إلى الأرض التي أراد فكبدته ملائكة رحمة متفقون هذا الحديث متفقون عليه الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رضي الله تعالى عن السادة التابعين وعلماء العاملين وأئمة الأربعة المجتهدين ومقلدين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. الحمد لله الحمد لله we praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And what we want to do for the few minutes that we have left is that we want to discuss and extract some benefit from a well-known hadith that I'm pretty sure most, if not all of you, have heard. Alhamdulillah, the book that I have in my hand is a famous book by a famous author. And not only he's famous, he's one of those authors who Allah has given maqbuliyah, acceptance by the people. The name of the book is Riyadu Salihin, Gardens of the Righteous. And it's written by Imam An-Nawawi. Very famous author. He wrote the most famous collections. There are hundreds, maybe even thousands of books entitled 40 Hadith, but his is the most famous. 40 Hadith of Imam An-Nawawi. He wrote Al-Adhkar. He wrote a commentary on Sahih Muslim, which is one of my favorites. I use it all the time. He wrote this book, Gardens of the Righteous. It's easy to find, and it's usually in two volumes. This is volume one, Arabic and English is there. Alhamdulillah. He also wrote Adabul Fatwa wa Mufti wa Mustafti, a very small book talking about the manners and etiquettes of fatwa, the fatwa itself. How a fatwa is supposed to look. How a fatwa is not supposed to look. And also the etiquette of the Mufti, the one who's giving the fatwa. How is he supposed to be? What is his qualification? What's the qualifications of the Mufti? And Mustafti, the one asking the questions. As Muslims, we have to be careful about how we ask questions and who we ask questions of. It's a very small book, alhamdulillah. He wrote that as well. This is one of those books. If you don't have it on your shelf, your bookshelf is naqis, it's deficient. You need it. Back in the day, everybody had Imam Nawawi's 40 Hadith, Riyadu Salihin, or Gardens of the Righteous. If you don't have it, you need to get it right away. This book covers, it's a book of, most people look at it as a book of hadith, because it's a collection of hadith. But one of the things I believe that makes the author stand out amongst many authors is, as we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given his books and his works acceptance by the people and all of the scholars of his time and after his time. But like this book, not only did he arrange it based upon subject matter, but he begins the chapters with the ayats that are directly connected with the subject matter. And this is important, especially for English speaking people, because a lot of times we read a verse of the Quran in English and we think the verse is saying something or proving something or disproving something that it doesn't. So that's why it's important to, first and foremost, consult human scholars, but when you read books, trustworthy scholars, that's going to connect you back to Allah and His Messenger. فَاسْأَلُوا أَحْلَ الذِّكْرَ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ask the people of the reminder if you do not know. The people of the reminder are those people who not only have knowledge, it's a beautiful thing about it. Allah then says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَحْلَ الْإِلْمِ. Ask the people of knowledge if you don't know. Allah did not say that. Allah said, ask the people of dhikr, the reminder. The scholars define the people of dhikr are people that have one thing in addition to knowledge. taqwa, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't only ask the one who has knowledge, ask the one who has taqwa. So in this book, he arranges the subject matter and he puts the ayats that are directly related to that subject matter. And then he mentions the hadith. So, alhamdulillah. And we said this book, if you don't have it already, you need to get it. It's easy to find. It's usually two volumes, English, Arabic. If you have three or four copies, you don't have too many. You can never have too many. Enough. And there's been many commentaries written on this book as well. So it's important. Alhamdulillah. We mentioned a verse that he mentions in the beginning. And this is the section on Tawbah, on repentance. He mentions a verse from Surah An-Nur, amongst other verses of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala altogether, O you who believe, if you want to be successful. La'alakum tuflihun, so that you will be successful. And so you find repentance or tawbah connected with our success. And falaha, or being successful, is the ability to reap the benefits of what you have sown. When you plant something in the ground, it's not a guarantee that what you planted will grow. Success is that when you do something, that you get the reward from it. When you plant the seed, you will get the crop. Tubu ilallahi jamia. Ayyuha al-mu'minuna la'allakum tuflihun. Return to Allah altogether. We have to be people constantly making tawbah. And what is tawbah? I still hear a lot, and it's amazing that I still hear it. If sometimes you may confront a brother or a sister about something, and they will say, Aki, I already made tawbah. I made my two rakats. Tawbah is not two rakats. Some of the scholars suggest that you make two rakats as a sign of your tawbah, but the two rakats in and of themselves is not the essence of tawbah. Tawbah has shurut. Tawbah has conditions. And some of those conditions are nadama, regret. So when we find that we have done some sin in the past, but we gloat over it and fantasize about when we used to do it, that's a sign that we have not made tawbah, because we don't regret it. When you regret something, you wish you didn't remember it. You're like, oh man, don't even remind me. That's nadama, that's the regret. That's one of the conditions of tawbah. Another condition of tawbah is the intention never to return to the sin again. You may fall short, but you have, at the time that you make tawbah, you have the sincere intention never to do it again. We live in a day and age where people make preemptive tawbah to preempt the sin that they're going to do. I'm going to give you an example of what I'm talking about. There was a sister who was a new shahada. And the brother who's supposed to be her wali is teaching her Fatiha, teaching her the first surah of the Quran. They're all alone. And so she memorized Fatiha. And he was like, you know, congratulations, and gave her a kiss. And, you know, the kiss, you know, got hot. And the new shahada said, are we supposed to be doing this? And the brother said, don't worry about it, we're going to make tawbah later. He planned to do a sin, zina. And he also planned to make tawbah for it. That's not tawbah, that's backwards. And believe it or not, a lot of people think that this is acceptable, that this is normal. Okay, I can do sin, as long as I make tawbah afterwards. And you have people literally planning to sin, and then, okay, I'm going to do the tawbah afterwards. It's not tawbah. So you have the intention not to return to the sin. And the scholars have broken down these categories in different ways. Some have made subcategories. Another condition of tawbah is that if your sin affected somebody else, maybe you stole some money from them, maybe you slandered them, maybe you did something, you took a right that belongs to somebody else. One of the conditions of tawbah is that you do what's called raddu madhalim, which means you undo your act of injustice. So if I stole your $100, then later on, I feel sorry about that. I said, I feel bad. I should have took that money. Astaghfirullah, let me make tawbah. My tawbah is not complete. I need to give him his money back. And this is why we have to be careful about what we say and what we do. Because a lot of us, we hurt and offend other people, and then later on we regret and want to make tawbah, but we're scared to approach that person. Because maybe if the person knows that you did what you did, he may put a hurting on you. And so now all of a sudden, now you get scared. But what you wasn't scared when you did that thing to him though. And a lot of people who claim to have knowledge, they always find a way to get out of something. And so the scholars say that if you fear that, you know, you making tawbah or returning the act of injustice will bring about more of an injustice, then you don't have to tell them. Like say if you slandered him or you slandered her. You don't have to say, oh brother, I slandered you. Maybe you can substitute that with doing some good deed in their name and pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. And people always jump to that because people don't want to be held accountable. And so people always use that loophole. Well, Allah knows best if that's a sufficient loophole for you. So part of making tawbah is raddu madhalim, undoing the act of injustice. So these are some of the conditions of tawbah. Tawbah is not 2 rakat. You raise H-E-L-L all throughout the land, you go crazy, these are Allahu Akbar, and it's all over with. That's not tawbah. That's Mickey Mouse Islam. That's not real Islam. That's Disney Islam. You have to undo what you did. Even the word tawbah itself means to return, to go back. And to be able and willing to make tawbah is a sign that Allah turned to you. Because tawbah means to turn. So for any of us to make tawbah is a sign that Allah turned to us in forgiveness. Because it's Allah that turns to us and that will enable and allow us to return to Him. So this is the conditions of tawbah. Now let's go through this hadith that we mentioned. It was narrated on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, and this is very early in the book. It's hadith number 20. Easy number to remember. Hadith number 20. A person from amongst the nations of the past had killed 99 people. You know the hadith. And other riwayas, other narrations of the hadith says this man was from Bani Israel. So Abu Sa'id al-Khudri is telling us that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that a man from amongst the nations of the past had killed 99 people. And then he asked the people, who is the most learned person of this land, of the land? And so they directed him to a monk, a rahib. They directed him to a monk. And the man said, I killed 99 people. Is there a way for me to make tawbah? No, the monk said, black. No. Period. You done off. It's over with. Collage. So the man killed him. Alhamdulillah. The man killed him. So now he killed 100 people. And so then he went to the people and asked them again, who is the most knowledgeable person of the land, of this place? And the people referred him to Rajulan Aliman, a man of knowledge. And this is beautiful. You can't overlook stuff like this when you read the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Buwithu bi jawabi al-qalam." I have been sent with very comprehensive words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't have like a slip of the tongue or say something that he doesn't mean, but he really meant that. No, his words may be understood on different levels, but if he said it, he means it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said the first man was a rahib, he was a monk. The man asked for a man of knowledge, but he was referred to a monk. What's one lesson we can learn from this? Just because somebody has a title, that doesn't mean that they really earn that title. Just because somebody has religious authority, that doesn't mean that they have the best knowledge that can benefit the people. This man was no benefit. So Allah used this mass murder. He's a mass murderer. He killed 99 people. To purify the earth of this rahib, this monk, killed him. So now he killed 100 people. And then he was referred to a man of knowledge. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't say rahib the second time. He said a rajulan alim. He was referred to a man of knowledge. A man who actually had knowledge. Another lesson we can extract from this is that when somebody asks you a question, you give them the best answer. Refer them to somebody that can really help you. So he was referred to this man of knowledge. And he asked this man, he said, I killed 100 people. Is there a way for me to make tawbah? Is there a way for me to repent? The man said, na'am. The exact opposite of what the first man said. Laugh. The first man said, no. And you, what you did is so bad. There's no way out for you. I don't even know why you're still living. It's over with for you. But the second man, nah. And he said, who is it that can come between a man and tawbah? And this is one of the lessons of tawbah. This is the thing about tawbah. If you're breathing, if you hear my voice right now, regardless of what you have done, you can seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not over with for you. Anybody who tells you that it's over with for you has lied. I don't care what your situation is. I don't care what your situation is. If you're still breathing, you have a way out. There's a makhraj for you. You can't, the only time you can stop making tawbah is when your soul is leaving your body. That last death gargle. That's it. Anytime before then, you can make tawbah. You can return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The believer, he's in the middle between Kauf and Rajah. Kauf is fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You fear his punishment. And Rajah is hope in Allah's mercy. The believer is not too extreme on either side. The believer is not everything he does all kind of sense. Well, Allah is like Ghafoor Rahim. Allah is all forgiving, most merciful. I just stole from him. I just killed him. I just raped her. I just slandered him. Aki, what you go, you crazy? Allahu Ghafoor Rahim, Aki. Allah is all forgiving, most merciful. No. And then you on the other side. You know, I can't even breathe. Why? Because I'm just scared. Allah going to punish me for breathing wrong. Shut up, Aki. It's in the middle. Between hope and fear. You need a balance. The believer's exactly in the middle. And so, the man said, there's nothing that can come between you and come between and tawbah. And then listen to what the man of knowledge told him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not a man to waste his breath. He told us the story for a reason. He said, go to such and such land. In that land are people who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Worship Allah with them. Go to such and such land. There are people in that land who worship Allah. Go worship Allah with them. He could have said, go to such and such land. But a lot of us, in this way, the culture we are, we think that we are something because we're near to it. In other words, a lot of us think we're special because we're near a movie star, or a rapper, or a singer, or a politician. And so we try to get pictures with these politicians. We think we're special because you're next to him. Or, you know, a lot of us Muslims, so a lot of us, you know, instead of rappers and singers and actors and actresses, the shuyukh become the pop stars. So we go to, from conference to intensive and get pictures with the Sheikh. I'm hyped just because, didn't you see the picture? I'm standing right next to him. But you're not doing what he's doing. You're not even helping him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told that, he said that the man told him to not only go to the land, he said there are righteous people there, they're worshiping Allah, worship Allah with them. You have to be active. You have to be doing what the righteous people do and do it with them. He didn't say, oh, you killed 99 people, 100 people. You can make time of going in a little corner by yourself, all by yourself until you get your mind right. Cry and moan about your situation, how bad you are, and don't come out before the people until a year later, until you get your mind right. No. When we encourage to do that, that's Shaitan talking to us. That's Shaitan. Shaitan will tell us, well, nah, I will be around you, brothers, but no, I ain't right. Okay, I gotta go off to myself and get myself right. And usually when we say by ourselves, it ain't by ourselves. It's with some other people who's sinning. That's doing what we doing, who agrees with what we doing, and is not gonna check us about it. But we say, no, I need to be off to myself, get my mind right. That's Shaitan. You're never gonna get right. You get right by being with people who are right. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the man told him, they worship Allah with them. And then he said, don't go back to your land. Because your land is an evil land. The important thing about this, he told the man to make hijrah. He told the man to get up from where he was and go someplace else. If your environment is that bad where it's making you kill 100 people, you just snap and you killing people. Man gave you bad advice and you killed him. You need to leave. You need to go. A lot of us, we don't like to leave. We don't like to go. Some of us, pretty sure nobody in this room, but there's people, you know there's people that never left their neighborhood? You talking about taking a road trip, Aki. Man, let's go to Cleveland. Cleveland? I don't know, man. You would think you asked him to go to Australia. He said, Cleveland, 2 hours away, Aki. I don't know, and it's somewhere they'll never go. You just don't even ask them to go anywhere. Because they don't want to move. They don't want to go anywhere. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, the righteous, all these people that we quote, they were never afraid to go. They were always willing to uproot themselves and go where they needed to go to get what they needed to get. He told the man to make hijrah and separate himself from his evil man. Extremely important. And so, the man took his advice. Amazing thing. Something so simple as that. The man didn't say, oh, you know, that's deep. Word. Yo, yeah, because my land is evil. And he all and philosophize it and break it down. You know, this movie maker, is it wajib or is it mandub? Is it mustahab? You know, what category is it in? He didn't try to philosophize about it. He did it. He actually did it. A lot of us, we get beneficial advice. You know, Aki, you know you're right. You know, I already know. See, I know myself. And, you know, this is the way I am. And you advise people, they always know themselves. But they're always in the same situation. Aki, you know you like this? Yeah, I know. You know, that's just the way I do. Yeah, the proof against what I'm doing is such and such verse from the Quran and such hadith. And you know, such and such Sheikh told me, you can break your whole sickness down, but you won't take the medicine. That's like going to the doctor. You went to the trouble, you got the insurance. You went to the doctor's appointment. He gave you the prescription. He gave you what to do, aftercare. And you had a long conversation with the doctor. You even called to get more advice. You even Googled the sickness. And you sitting there with the medicine in your house about to expire, all the instructions from the hospital to take when you leave, and it's just sitting there, you're not taking it. This is the situation with a lot of us. We know what our sickness is, we know what the problem is, but we're not doing anything about it. We know, it's all cerebral. We know we can break this thing down. But we're not doing anything. Yeah, I know. That's the first thing to say. Yeah, I know. I know. I'm supposed. You know? How do you know? Do you understand that you will be held accountable for what you know? Do you know that on the day of judgment, somebody that knows two people done the same sin? Do you think that the one who knows more is going to get punished than the more less than the one or equal to the one who knows less? You think the scholar who goes to the club and gets drunk is going to get the same punishment as the one who just took shahada and goes to the club and gets drunk? Al-yastawi alladhina ya'lamun wa la ya'lamun. Are they equal, those who know and those who don't know? Alhamdulillah, this man, he heard and he heeded the advice and he left. He started to go to the land. And Allah took his soul. Doubt, death came to him, as the hadith says. Atahul maut, death came to him. When he died, two sets of angels descended. Angels of Rahmah, mercy, to take possession of his soul. And another group of angels descended. Malaikatul Adab, angels of punishment. They descended to take possession of his soul. The beautiful thing, again, with what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is telling us, is the argument that the angels had. The angels of mercy said his heart changed. He was on the way to make tawbah. The angels of punishment said, this person never did a good thing in his life. He said he never did a good thing in his life, not one good thing. He said, innahum lam ya'mal khayran qattu. He never did one good thing in his life. Think about it. I'm sure all of us have done something good in our life. This person never did nothing good in his life. He was on the way to do the first good thing. And Allah took his soul. Another angel descended in the form of a man. And they agreed to let this angel arbitrate and be the judge to settle this dispute. And his answer, his judgment, was that they measured the land. Start from the point where he died and measure back to where he came from, the evil land. And again, measure from where he's at and measure to where he was going. If he's closer to where he's going, then you angels of mercy, you take his soul. If he's closer to where he came from, you angels of punishment, you take his soul. And so they carried out the measurement. And they found that he was closer to where he was going. And the angels of mercy took his soul. Now there's various narrations of this hadith. Some narrations say that Allah ordered the land to shrink between himself and where he was going, so that he will be closer to that place. Some narrations said that the man was like almost dying on the halfway mark. And before Allah took his soul, he crawled to make it closer to where he was at. Here's a person who killed 100 people. I don't think any of you killed 100 people. But Allah forgave this man. And he was granted paradise. And the angels of mercy took his soul. Because he made sincere tawbah. And he acted on the advice of the man of knowledge. And it was going with the people of who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Allah with them. And there's another major lesson that comes from this. Allah holds us accountable for our intentions and our actions. The outcome of our actions is not in our hands. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have the intention to do good, and you make effort to do good, and that action is according to the Quran and the Sunnah, in other words, The ends don't justify the means. In other words, I'm robbing this bank so we get money to the masjid. No. Your intention was good to give money to the masjid, the action was wrong. Both need to be correct. Action, the intention and the action. If you attempt to do something good, and the method by which you're doing it is correct, but you fail, or you die before the end result comes about, you get rewarded as if you succeeded. Hope you understand that. You get rewarded as if you done it, even though you may have failed, even though the project may have flopped. On your scale, you get the reward of having completed it. Because you're not blamed, you're not taken to account for the outcome. The outcome is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's coming upon us is proper intentions and proper actions. And as we mentioned, this hadith is mutafiqun alayh. Whenever you hear that term, that means it's in Bukhari and Muslim. It's agreed upon by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim. So inshallah, we pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we get benefit from that. Inshallah. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us turn back to Him in sincere repentance. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our ta'ala. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us in the middle, in between fear and hope. Not to either extreme.
Imam Naeem Abdullah of Masjid Al Mu'min and Nur Zaman Institute is available for speaking engagements. You can contact Imam Naeem Abdullah at the following: via telephone at 267-388-0823, or write him at 537 Paulson Avenue, Pittsburgh, PA 15206, or via email at imamnaeem@nurzamaninstitute.org.
Bismillah. Muhammadun